Well, this morning we're going to be looking at Galatians chapter 6, particularly in verses 7 through 10. What I'd like to do is read verses 1 through 10 to get a bit of the context. We're going to be dealing primarily with verses 7 and 8 this morning, and then look at verses 9 and 10 this evening. Would you listen carefully as I read this? This is not the word of man. This is God's word. Paul writes to the Galatians, "Brethren, even if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself, so that you too will not be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each one must examine his own work, and then he will have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone, and not in regard to another, for each one will bear his own load. The one who is taught the word is to share all good things with the one who teaches him. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he will also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we do not grow weary. So then, while we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, and especially to those who are of the household of the faith." May the Lord bless his word to our building up in the Lord Jesus this morning. Now, as a reminder, last week, Paul was reminding us, and actually we looked at several texts that had to do with our union with the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember all the different images that the Lord gives us of this relationship in Scripture. We are so many living stones put together into a temple that our Lord inhabits. That expresses union. We are the temples of the Holy Spirit. We are the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ, and He is our husband. What more intimate union is there than the marriage relationship? And that is what the Lord has chosen to express our relationship with Him. We are His body, and He is our head. We are in a living union with the Lord Jesus Christ. As the head is the one who gives directions to the body, we take our directions from the Lord, but also as the body basically draws all of its life from the source of life. In this case, it's the head, our Lord Jesus Christ, so we draw our life from Him. Now, we were reminded that our union with Jesus means at least two things. First of all, that we share in what belongs to Him. We share in the Lord's life. He has given us eternal life, and we will never perish. We share in His Holy Spirit, which is something we've been looking at on Wednesdays as we've been looking at Sinclair Ferguson, who is the Holy Spirit. He talked about who He was and how the Lord Jesus has given us of His Spirit. He is the Spirit of Christ. He is the Lord's companion, and He has become our companion. Jesus has given us His Holy Spirit that He might be our comforter, that He might be our counselor, that He might be our guide, so that we might become like Him. So we share in His life, we share in His Spirit, and we share in His blessings. Everything that the Father has promised to give the Lord Jesus Christ for the work that He has done, He has also promised to give to us, and that includes His inheritance. When Jesus inherits the kingdom of heaven, when He inherits the new heavens and the new earth, we will inherit it, we will receive it with Him. But we also saw, and this is kind of what we're going to focus on today, we also saw that the sharing works the other way as well. I mean, what belongs to Jesus becomes ours, but He also shares in what belongs to us. We saw that there are at least two implications of this. The first one was, and we're not going to focus primarily on this today, but one that I wanted to remind us of because I wonder how many of us have forgotten from last week what union with Jesus actually means. If we are the members of Christ, if we belong to Him, if we are in this living union, this vital union with the Lord Jesus, when we then choose to sin, we involve Jesus in that sin. He has somewhat of a share in it. Remember how Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6 that we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. Should we take the members of Christ and join them to a harlot? God forbid that we would ever do that. And the reason is because we belong to Jesus, our bodies belong to Him, our souls belong to Him, we are united to Him. We don't take what belongs to Him and use it or misuse it in a way that would be dishonoring to Him, because we are His members. We must not use what He has given to us or what belongs to Him for something He doesn't approve of, something that not only is that going to, of course, dishonor Him and grieve Him, it's also going to injure us and certainly injure other people as well. When we think about sin, when we're presented with that opportunity, and we certainly are all the time, we need to choose not to sin. We should think twice about it, realizing that we do involve Jesus in that sin. But secondly, the fact that what we have belongs to Him means this, that if the Lord is going to do anything in this world, He's going to do it through us. We are His workers. We are His hands. We're His feet. We're His mouth. We are the ones He works through. That is what the book of Acts is all about. We often look at the book of Acts as, you know, basically an account of the people who loved Jesus and were devoted to Him and what they did for His glory, which is why it's called the Acts of the Apostles. This is what they did. But remember, we should really look at it as the continuing acts of our Lord Jesus Christ, because the work they did was the work He did through them. This is Jesus using the members of His body to do the work of the kingdom of heaven. Well, that's what the Lord wants to do through us. And it's certainly clear from Scripture. And as we look at the world around us, there's still a great deal of work to be done. And Jesus wants to continue that work, but He wants to do it through us because that is how He works. Now today, what I'd like us to do is focus on how, realizing that that is the case, how we might be more usable to Him. Paul gives us a very basic principle, one which is shot throughout Scripture, as I've already been reminding you. It's a very basic principle, but a very important one, and one that can help us to serve Jesus better if we apply it faithfully. Paul writes in Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, this he will also reap." Now, if you want to be more usable to the Lord Jesus, the point that we're going to be looking at today is simply this: you need to sow to the Spirit and don't sow to the flesh. Now, first of all, Paul is reminding us that we do need to be doing something. We need to be sowing. And what he means by that, of course, is investing ourselves, investing our lives in the kingdom of heaven for His glory if we are to reap a harvest. Paul draws his image here from something his audience would be very familiar with, something we're very familiar with as well, because every culture, every society depends on this for their existence, and that is agriculture, that is farming. We do need to remember that Jesus and the apostles often used agricultural images because they were primarily an agrarian society. Now, every farmer, and of course those familiar with farming, if they weren't in farming, and certainly we may not all of us be farmers, but we're familiar with this principle because we've seen it enough. We know that if you do not sow, you're not going to reap anything. If you don't plant seed, you won't have a harvest. Now, I hope Dick doesn't mind my using him as an example this morning, but since he is a farmer and he's doing this agricultural work, we perhaps can learn something from him. Our brother Dick, as you know, farms cherries. But if he had never planted trees to begin with, any cherry trees, if he hadn't nurtured and cared for those trees meticulously through the years, he would never be able to reap any cherries. If he hadn't invested himself in this, if he hadn't done the necessary work, then he wouldn't have a crop to harvest. You have to sow in order to reap. Now, we saw earlier how Jesus used this analogy, basically, when he was explaining the work that he calls us to do, the work of evangelism. He wants us to invest our lives in others. He wants us to share what he has done with us and done in our lives through the gospel with others. Now this, he says, is like sowing seed. In this case, of course, the seed of the gospel. It's going to fall into different types of soil, which we saw earlier and noted earlier, represents the different conditions of the heart, and its fruitfulness depends on those conditions. Not everybody's going to come to Christ, but some will by God's grace. But again, the point is this. If we don't sow any seed, if we don't share the gospel with anyone, how many of those people are actually going to come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? How much fruit is going to be born? How much is going to be reaped? How great of a harvest is there going to be? Well, the answer, of course, is there isn't going to be any fruit. There isn't going to be any harvest, no reaping, as it were, because nothing is sown. Where nothing is sown, nothing is reaped. The only people who come to the Lord Jesus Christ, the only ones who were saved, the only ones then who are brought to a place who bear fruit, are those who actually have the gospel planted. Somebody brought it to them. Seed must be sown in order to have a harvest. The gospel has to be shared if people are to be saved. So if we are to see any kind of a harvest, we obviously need to be sowing. And that's the first point. You don't sow, you don't reap. But it's also true that you will reap only what you sow. And we're getting closer now to what Paul is talking about here. Now, Dick knows that when he goes out to harvest this particular year, that he's not going to go out and harvest peaches. He's not going to go out and harvest apples from the trees that he's planted. He's only going to harvest cherries from the cherry trees. And he will do that, as we understand from the parable of the sower, actually, and as every farmer knows by experience, he will harvest those cherries only if the Lord wills. It's in God's hands. We plant, we water, but God is the one who causes the growth. He is the one who allows the harvest. Ultimately, it is in his hands. But you're only going to harvest what you're actually planting. God has constituted things in such a way that like only begets like. People beget people, as you know, not other things. Birds beget birds, reptiles beget reptiles, and so on. By the way, this is, and I'm just going to say this as an aside because I thought it was appropriate at this point, this is one of the reasons, one of the many reasons, why evolutionary theory cannot be true, because like begets like. You only reap what you sow. One species cannot come from another, which is what evolution teaches. Now, you know, evolution believes that at some point, fish crawled out of the ocean and became amphibians. Amphibians became mammals and reptiles. Reptiles became birds. Mammals became man. And then they believe some of those mammals basically spent too much time in the water and actually became aquatic mammals. So this idea of changing from one species to another, happening either slowly over a period of time through many changes or all at once through one great change. An alligator lays eggs, a chicken hatches from one of those eggs. But true science, as you know, is based on observation. It has to be something you can see. It has to be repeatable. And obviously, when we look at the world around us, we don't see these things happening. We don't see one species changing into another. We don't see these big leaps from one thing to another. What you sow, you reap. And I think, again, science tells us that even the physical world around us is a grand illustration of that very principle, which is why evolution can't be true. By the way, we're going to see how this works in the spiritual realm as well. If it were true in the physical realm, perhaps we would suspect it might be true in the spiritual realm. You can sow one thing and get another. But it's not true in the physical realm. God has shown us quite plainly that's the case. It's not going to be true in the spiritual either. And that's really Paul's main point here, isn't it? He writes in verse 8, "For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life." Now, the farmer obviously has a choice of what it is he's going to plant. When he looks at his field, what kind of a farmer do I want to be? Do I want to raise cherries? Do I want to raise peaches, apricots? Do I want to grow wheat or oats or corn, something else? The fact is, we have a choice as well, don't we, when we go out to sow. Now, Paul tells us it's a choice between two different things. It's not really a choice between many, although in these two main categories, there are a lot of smaller choices we can make. But the two main categories are this. We can either sow spiritual things, or we can sow fleshly things. And depending upon what we sow, we're either going to reap the benefits, if they are spiritual things, eternal life, or the consequences, which is corruption. Now, trying to understand what Paul means here, the question is he speaking more broadly about salvation, or is he speaking more narrowly about the small choices we make as believers? Well, I think he's actually talking about both. This principle is true more broadly with regard to salvation. What we sow, we're going to reap. It's one of the ways we can actually know whether or not we belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, whether we have His Spirit in our souls creating this union with the Lord Jesus Christ and His life, as we saw last week. Now, Paul tells us first in verse 8, "For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption." What is Paul talking about here? Well, the verb tense in the Greek, which in this case is the present tense, shows us a bit more clearly what Paul has in mind. The present tense generally refers to a continuing action, something that isn't done once, but something that is repeated over and over and over again. Paul here is talking about somebody who habitually does things that are fleshly, things that feed the flesh. In other words, he's talking about somebody who is continually sinning. Now, Paul says the one who is continually sowing to the flesh is eventually going to reap something, and it's going to be, of course, connected to what it was he sowed. If you continually sow to the flesh, if you continually sin, you are going to reap corruption. Now, here's another area where, again, we don't know exactly what Paul's referring to, but it could be one of two things. He's referring either to moral corruption, and he's saying that is an individual, whether he's a Christian or not, the more he sins, the more he sows to the flesh, the more he's going to reap moral corruption, which means a disposition to sin even more. Or the word can refer to destruction, which means that in the end, his soul will decay. Now, actually, both of these things are true. The one who continually sows to the flesh, the one who practices sin, and again, sin being the things that are contrary to God's law, will in the end be destroyed. And the reason is, as John tells us, it's because he hasn't been born again of God. Listen to what John writes in 1 John 3, verses 4 through 9. He says this, "Everyone who practices sin also practices lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness." By the way, we're going to come back to this evening. Sin is the breaking of the law of God. How do we know what sowing to the flesh is? It's doing things that God tells us not to do, or not doing things that God tells us to do. He goes on to say this, "You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin." No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has seen him or knows him. Before we panic, because surely you've read this verse at some point in your lives and said, wait a minute. John is saying here that if you abide in Jesus, you don't sin. But I do sin. Am I a Christian? Well, again, the present tense is used here, and what he's talking about is the practice of sin. Basically, no one who abides in him practices sin. No one who practices sin has seen him or knows him. And then the meaning is brought out in these latter verses. Little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who practices sin is of the devil. For the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. No one who is born of God practices sin, because his seed abides in him and he cannot sin. That is, he cannot practice sin because he is born of God. Now, John is basically saying this. Jesus came into the world to do what we sang a little bit earlier, Augustus Toplady was telling us. He has come to be the double cure of sin, to cleanse us from its guilt, but also to break the power of sin in our lives. Now, if we are believers, if we really are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus has broken the power of sin in our lives. He has destroyed the works of the devil. Remember what the devil's work was, to deceive Adam and Eve, to make them fall into sin so that the whole human race would become corrupt. And that's why we come into the world in the condition we are. Jesus came to destroy that work of the enemy, to free us from our guilt, and to break the power of sin. And when he breaks the power of sin, that means that that person, that means us, we are no longer going to practice sin, but now we are going to practice righteousness. So, if the Lord has done that work in us, we will no longer practice sin. We will not continually be sowing to the flesh so that we reap destruction in the end. Now, by the way, I should mention, and I think it's implied in what I've just said, John is not telling us that if we fall into sin, that we're not born of God. If we fall into a particular sin over and over again, that we are not born of God. He says if we practice sin, we are not born of God. And we have to remember what it means to practice sin. It means when you do something that is wrong, and you know it's wrong, and you don't put up any kind of struggle against it, but you give yourself over to it, that is the person who is not born of God. That is the person in whose life the devil's work has not been destroyed. That is the one who is basically, well, who is still on his way to destruction. Now, if that happens to be true of us, whether that particular sin is doing something the Lord tells us not to do and we keep doing it, or we're not doing something the Lord tells us to do and we continually refuse to do it, and we don't put up any kind of struggle against it, then we really do not know the Lord. And if that is the case with any of you here this morning, you need to sow to the Spirit by trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, turning from your sins and believing on him. Now, we do know, if we do know the Lord, the opposite is going to be true. We're going to be continually sowing to the Spirit. We are going to be practicing what the Lord says is right. If that's true of us, we are born again. We do have eternal life. We will be received into heaven on the day of his judgment. Again, let me note what John says in 1 John 3:7. Little children, make sure no one deceives you. The one who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. And again, he's not talking about a perfect practice of righteousness, because only Jesus was ever able to do that. He's talking about the pattern of our lives, giving ourselves to do what is right. It's the same thing that Paul means in Galatians 6:8, but the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. If you're practicing righteousness, you're righteous even as he is righteous, you're born again of God, you're going to inherit the kingdom. So these principles are true broadly. You're going to reap what you sow. If you're continually sowing to the flesh, you're going to reap destruction. If you're continually sowing to the Spirit, you're going to reap eternal life. But now getting more, again, to the point of what we want to see. How can this teach us to be more usable by the Lord Jesus? Well, we do need to understand that what is true broadly is also true more narrowly. If we are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, and we allow sin in our lives, if we're sowing to the flesh, it is going to affect us. Whatever we sow, we're going to reap. If we sow moral corruption, we're going to reap moral corruption, which means the more we give ourselves over to sin, the less we're going to want to do what the Lord tells us is right, and the stronger our desire is going to be for those things that are wrong. It's kind of like, again, the idea of the two dogs, you know. The one you feed the most is going to be the strongest, that they're equal in every other way. We have two principles in our hearts. If we feed the fleshly principle, it's going to be stronger. But if we feed the spiritual principle, if we sow to the Spirit, it will be stronger. Paul says, if we sow to the Spirit, we will from the Spirit reap eternal life and everything that actually comes from that, which would include spiritual strength. The more we do what is right, the more we're going to want to do what's right, because the more we're going to have of the Spirit's influence. We will reap what we sow. Now, doesn't everybody believe this? Well, apparently not, because Paul actually writes to them to try to get them to see that this connection exists. He says in verse 7, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he will also reap." I mean, Paul is recognizing the fact that we can deceive ourselves. We can be deceived into thinking that somehow this principle doesn't hold true, or else maybe it doesn't apply to us, everybody else it applies to, but not to me. I can sow sin and reap righteousness. I can do what other people cannot do. But if we think that way, we're wrong. We need to trust what God says and not what we think. I mean, the Lord actually warns us not to trust our own hearts through Jeremiah when he says in Jeremiah 17, verse 9, "The heart is more deceitful than all else and is desperately sick. Who can understand it?" Now, Jeremiah here, the Lord is not referring merely to unbelievers. It applies to all people. Even as believers, we have two principles in our hearts, and we can be deceived by the one into thinking that God's truth is not truth, which is why Solomon warns us in Proverbs 24, verse 23. "Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the springs of life." Whenever we're tempted to think that we can do things that are wrong and somehow not reap the consequences, or somehow good's going to come out of it, we need to remember what Paul tells us here. Don't deceive yourself into thinking it's that way. Don't think that somehow it's going to turn out differently than what God plainly says in His Word. God will not be mocked. God is serious. God is going to make sure the connection holds. It's the way things are ordained, which is why He warns us against it. Now again, God may work our sins out for our good. He may even work good for us through the sins that we fall into, but that's only because God is gracious. He has not given us the principle, "Do sinful things, and I will bring good things out of it." He says, through Paul, "What, shall we sin, that grace may abound?" God forbid. How can we who have died to sin still live in it? We cannot practice sin and expect to go to heaven. That's quite clear. We can't really even allow room in our lives for any sins, even the occasional sin, and not expect to face some consequences. If you sow it into your life, it's going to bear some fruit in your heart and in your life. If you do something that's wrong, it's going to have consequences out there as well for other people. Now, we might expect it to be otherwise if something like evolution was true. If a farmer could plant wheat and harvest corn, if Dick could plant cherry trees and harvest peaches, then we might think, well, anything can happen. But that's not the way it is. There is a direct connection between what you sow and what you reap. If you sow to the flesh, you will reap corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap life, spiritual life, eternal life. So obviously, if you want to be useful to the Lord, if I want to be useful to the Lord, we all need to sow to the Spirit and avoid sowing to the flesh. Now again, that's a subject that we're going to look a little bit more carefully at this evening as we look at the next two verses. How can we be careful not to sow to the flesh, but more importantly, how can we sow to the Spirit? What is it that Paul has primarily in mind? How does the Lord want to use us? And in using us, what can we expect when he does? We'll take that up this evening, but for now, let's be reminded you will reap what you sow. Let's be careful to sow then good things, spiritual things. Sow to the Spirit. Do what is good. Let's be reminded by the table this morning, our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, what does this table actually remind us of except that our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to sow his own life? He was willing to invest himself in the work of salvation, and he has reaped a harvest of souls, people who love him, people who are going to be with him through all eternity, people he is united with and he loves as his own bride, people through whom he can do his work. We need to invest ourselves in what it is that Jesus invested himself in as well, because he made this investment so that he could have us, so that he could work through us to do what it is he wants to get done in this world. Let's bow for a moment of prayer, and let's ask that the Lord would help us to apply this, but also that he would prepare us to come to his table.